Hello friends, today I am going to demonstrate the experiment Kerr effect, and this is our setup. And this is a monochromatic light source, a helium neon laser. I am switching it on, and as you can see the light it passing through. But this source gives us unpolarized light which vibrates in the infinite number of planes around 360 degree. So we use a polarizer to pass through only a linear component of this unpolarized light. So the unpolarized light vibrates along number of planes, as we can see here using this model. Now when we put a polarizer, it restricts all the planes except only one plane to pass through. And now we will allow only a vertical component of the light, and that we can do by adjusting the setting of our polarizer. And as we can see here that only the vertically oriented linearly polarized light can pass through, and this we can verify using another polarizer which is called the analyzer. This vertically oriented and linearly polarized light will pass through the analyzer also only when both the polarizer and analyzer are oriented in the same manner. If analyzer is in the cross condition, this is called the cross condition, then it will not allow the light to pass through the analyzer. See, this light goes off. There is no light. And when the polarizer and analyzer are not crossed, then the light intensity is maximum at the detector. This we can read using a multimeter. This is connected to the multimeter, and this you will see, and this we will note as I naught. This is important to note here that this is dark room experiment, but we are doing in light. So some error will be there. The linearly polarized light is actually the vector sum of two mutually perpendicular components which are in phase.
These are mutually perpendicular.
And the vector sum is the vertically and linearly polarized light in the direction of propagation. These two components are called ordinary and extraordinary beams.
Here both the component are at 90 degree to the each other and emanating and ending at the same time. So both are in same phase. This is our Kerr cell which is placed between the polarizer and the analyzer. The actual Kerr cell contains nitrobenzene which requires thousands of voltage to show this phenomenon. It was first demonstrated by a Scottish physicist, John Kerr.
Here
we are using lead lanthanum zirconium titanate element or PLZT element as a Kerr cell, which needs comparatively less voltage to show the effect. Here, the Kerr cell is placed at 45 degree to the vertical, and its two ends, this one and this one, are connected to the high voltage power supply. So, when a vertically oriented, linearly polarized light passes through the Kerr cell, then its one component will be parallel to the Kerr cell or to the applied electric field, and the other component will be perpendicular to this applied field or Kerr cell. Now, making the cross condition, so there is no more light on the detector and the current in the multimeter becomes nearly zero, as you can see here. Now, switching on the high voltage power supply and its 10 units multiplier. Now, we will increase the voltage on the Kerr cell here. This is 50 volt with 10 multiplier. Now, as we increase the voltage on the Kerr cell, as we can see here, it is 100 volt now. The mutually perpendicular in-phase component of the linearly polarized light becomes out of phase. And this is that phase shift, and this phase shift is proportional to the square of the applied voltage. And after a phase shift of 180 degree, this vertically oriented linearly polarized light turn at right angle and pass through the analyzer even in the cross condition. And that we can see here practically, that as we increase the voltage on the Kerr cell, the vertically linearly polarized light start turning with the increase of the voltage, and corresponding to 180 degree phase shift, it turned by 90 degree and passed through the crossed analyzer.
Even in the cross condition.
As we can see, that intensity becomes maximum on the detector, which we can read in the multimeter. This is analogous to the vertical wave turn with the increase in the voltage becomes horizontal and then pass through. Ideally, the intensity corresponding to the 180 degree phase shift should equal to the intensity when polarizer and analyzer were not crossed. But practically, it is somewhat less than the I naught. And after 180 degree phase shift, it start reducing. Let us see how. Actually, the applied electric field causes the PLZT element to become bi-refractive. The component which oscillates parallel to the electric field of the PLZT element is delayed relative to the component which is vertical to the electric field of PLZT element. A phase shift is created, as you can see here, between the ordinary and extraordinary beams, and this phase shift increases with the increase in the applied voltage. Now, when there is no voltage on the Kerr cell, the light is linearly and vertically polarized. So, if we imagine a torch focusing the resultant vector, then the wavefront will be a vertically fluctuating line in the wall, which is the linearly polarized light in vertical direction. And because our polarizer and analyzer are in cross condition, so the light do not pass through the analyzer and there is no current in the multimeter. And with the increase in the voltage, we see that light start passing through the analyzer, comes on the detector, and current increases in the multimeter. This current increases with the increase in the voltage. As we see, initially when no voltage is applied, the light is linearly polarized in vertical direction. And with the application of voltage, as the phase shift becomes 180 degree, we can clearly see here that the light is no more vertical, but becomes horizontally linear now. Actually, with the phase shift, the vertically linear light start turning, and at a phase shift of 180 degree, it becomes completely horizontal and pass through the crossed analyzer. This is just analogous to this model representation. And this
journey of linearly polarized light from vertical to horizontal orientation completes through different polarization conditions. And these polarizations are linear, circular, and elliptical polarizations.
Actually, in case of linear polarization, only one axis involved. It may be either x-axis or the y-axis. As we can see here, that the light is linearly polarized here in y direction. This is the initial condition. When the waves, both the ordinary and extraordinary waves, are in same phase. And there is no involvement of x-axis. And after the 180 degree phase shift, as we can see here, this is the ...180 degree phase shift here. Again, the polarization is linear, but now this line is in x-axis. So here, the x-axis is involving now. As we can see, there is involvement of x-axis, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, in this way. So x-axis is involved and there is no any y-axis involvement. But other than the 0 degree or 180 degree phase shift, both the x and y-axis are involved and major and minor axes are created. As we can see here, that initially when the phase shift takes place, at this phase shift, this is making, the y-axis is making the major axis, but here the x-axis involvement is also there. As you can see here, the two part are covered. So this is making, the x-axis is making the minor axis. Similarly, again here, this one is having the major axis and this one is having, here is the minor axis. This is the major axis and this is the minor axis. We can observe that the y-axis is the major and the x-axis is minor axis. So there is a ellipse and the wavefront will be a vertical ellipse. This way. This is called the elliptical polarization. Now at 90 degree of phase shift, as we can see here,
This is the 90 degree phase shift. So the resultant vector is this one. This itself is the resultant vector. Here itself is the resultant vector. Similarly, this one is resultant vector, and this one is resultant vector. So as we can see, there is a circle. The wavefront is the circle. This is called the circular polarization. After the 90 degree phase shift, the y axis becomes the minor axis. As we can see here, very small parts are in contact here of both the waves. So this is making the minor axis, and the x axis is making the major axis. So this is the minor axis, and this is the major axis. This is the minor axis again, and here is the major axis. Again, this is the minor axis, this is the major. So again, there is a ellipse, but the direction is changed now, and this is a horizontal ellipse, is the wavefront. At complete 180 degree of phase shift, as we can see here, again, the wavefront is linear. There is a line, this, 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 this. But this is now horizontally linear. So that's why from 0 to 90 degree, 0 to 180 degree of phase shift, the vertically linearly polarized light turn and becomes a horizontal one and pass through the analyzer, which is in cross condition.
After 180 degree of phase shift, if we continue to increase the voltage, this horizontally oriented linearly polarized light also continue to turn through elliptical and circular polarization. So the light on the detector now start decreasing, and at complete 360 degree of phase shift, the light turn again to the vertical position. Thus, we see no light on the detector again. So we see here that with a continuous application of voltage on the Kerr cell, we get a number of maxima and minima of light intensity. Now we will increase the voltage on the Kerr cell and perform the experiment. Here we also applied a multiplier of 10 unit. This is the cross condition, and initially there is no light on the detector. Thank you.